Dear students, welcome to a corona-free classroom. How do you like my office? Kinda nice, eh? Anyway, today we're gonna focus on macroeconomics, the introduction of it. So it will be the highlights of chapter one, or lecture one, and it will focus on the rules of the game. I hope you'll enjoy it, and give me a thumbs up if you do like it. Welcome to ECON 222, Macroeconomics. This video will be an introduction to economics, the rules of the game, and lay the foundation for the weeks to come. In this class, you'll learn how to make sense of all the likes, wants, and needs from a macro perspective. You'll learn about a lot of the different tools that economists use to understand what's going on in the economy, and how we can make adjustments, and how we can invest based on it, or draw other conclusions like, is now a good time to take on a major project? We'll look at the law of supply and demand, comparative advantage, finding different ways how trade can become a win-win situation. Look at the trade-off between inflation and employment, and decisions that the Federal Reserve might take. Learn about different tools that could help you understand not only how inflation works and how Federal Reserve rates work, but also how you can figure out firm or industry-specific inflation that will help you make sure that you have good profit margins. We'll take a look at if a budget deficit is good or bad, or is it always bad, or is it always good? We will also look at how productivity is really everything in the long run, where credit or bank loans and such like that is important in the short run. Anytime I look at a country from a macro point of view, I always start out with what or who or what kind of economic philosophy inspired this particular nation state. In the United States, Milton Friedman has been inspiring capitalism in the way we understand it. John Maynard Keynes, although he didn't live at the same time as Milton Friedman, he had a great inspiration on how economics worked in England, how the world looked like during and after World War I, and even more so inspired the way we changed the way of life upon the conclusion of World War II. Today, he's inspired liberalism and socialism quite a bit. In fact, in Europe, Keynes is king. A topic that is typically taboo today is looking at a little bit what Friedrich Nietzsche said and how he partly inspired national socialism. And today it's kind of called state capitalism just because national socialism has a bad connotation to it. Karl Marx, yes, he lived a long time ago, but he inspired the Russian Revolution and Lenin and communism. Now, socialism and communism rebelled against each other 100 years ago when we had the Russian Revolution and so on, and there was all kinds of chaos across Europe. Socialism really split into two different parts. One is socialism and another part is communism, and they don't necessarily like each other. Some of the very important economic and financial models and tools that we will study and that you'll learn in other classes will include Adam Smith. He's really the father of macroeconomics. He looked at the world and studied it, and he saw how economies expanded and sometimes it contracted into recession. He found it very interesting. He said that it was like an invisible hand was controlling the world. That made him famous, by the way. Now, David Ricardo studied what Adam Smith had said and came up with the ideas of comparative advantage. He's the guy that came up with the ideas of, wow, what if England specialized in, say, kidney pie? And France will specialize in, say, wine and cheese. And if England trades with France and gives them all the surplus extra kidney pie that they have in England and export it to France, and they will be so happy in France that they now have kidney pie, that they will specialize in wine and cheese and export their surplus to England. And that way, both England and France can both enjoy more kidney pie, cheese, and wine than if they try to specialize in things that they don't have a comparative advantage in. Now, John Maynard Keynes received the Nobel Prize for Modern Portfolio Theory. He was a brilliant economist at Cambridge, and he could have probably received a Nobel Prize for all kinds of things that he did. His work is splendid, excellent, and well worth reading. Not only did he write an entire book on the consequences of the peace after World War I and outlined pretty much what was going to happen, and then it did, everyone's surprised that it actually did, that he became even more famous. So when World War II was coming to an end, he was a part of drafting up the plan for the post-war world. And that included things like the IMF, how shall money be valued, how should we do trade, how should we rebuild the world in the best way. Benjamin Graham would have taken John Maynard Keynes' writings and education, and from that he came up with the concept of value investing. He wrote the very famous book, The Intelligent Investor. He was also Warren Buffett's professor. So when Warren Buffett wanted to start his business that everyone knows and is a very famous firm, he asked his old professor, "Dear Professor Graham, would you want to be on the board of my company?" Well, naturally, Graham thought that was exciting. And having someone like Benjamin Graham on your board of directors made it easier for Warren Buffett to do really well. I'm sure that Warren Buffett was smart enough to do what he has done throughout his life and his career. But the big part of luck, never underestimate that sometimes we do need luck. And for Warren Buffett, that meant that Benjamin Graham joined him, which gave him a seal of approval from investors. Milton Friedman took all the work that Adam Smith did, David Ricardo, John Maynard Keynes, Benjamin Graham, and took it even further. He focused on macroeconomics, in which he received the Nobel Prize in the 70s. Milton Friedman is a free market capitalist. He believes in a small government with few regulations and allowing the will of the people decide what to do. He would probably agree with a lot of the things that Hayek and Austrian economics believe in. So in many ways, he's a very traditional conservative. You can see Milton Friedman argue some of his key ideas in the 1970s television show on Donahue. It was 1979. Markovitch received the Nobel Prize for Modern Portfolio Theory. He even took it even further, followed by Jack Tranier, William Sharp, and Lindner and Mawson and so on. They all worked on different types of ways of figuring out risk and return, and that really goes into finance now. But from a macro point of view, these are key gauges to pay attention to. To better understand like, wants, and needs, we also have to understand the culture of the people that are drawing these conclusions. So that means that we have to understand the religion, the political philosophy, economic philosophy, education, language, and social structure. Once we know all those parts, we understand the culture, the norms, and the value systems that helps them make decisions. So what is culture? Culture is that complex whole which includes knowledge, belief, art, morals, laws, customs, and other capabilities acquired by a man or woman as a member of society. And that's the definition of Edward Taylor. Another definition is a system of values and norms that are shared among a group of people and when taken together constitutes a design for living. And that's a description by Hofstede, Namenvirst, and Weber. This is a picture that explains how complex the economy is from a macro point of view. First, you have culture. And some cultures are more focused on an individualistic point of view, and other are more collectivistic. Now, if someone from a foreign country comes and visited us, we might have a sense that something is strange with this foreigner, and that's called ethnocentrism. That's when we react against someone from a different culture. Now, if we go to a different country, say that we would leave Wisconsin and go to China or Germany or, you know, South Africa or something like that, we will have something called a culture shock, because it's us as an individual who actually has a shock over how different all these norms are in the culture that we are actually meeting. So in some cases, we might meet someone that's a foreigner that's having a culture shock, and we have an ethnocentric point of view of that foreigner, because that could happen at the same time. Now, language barrier is always a part, and how you structure sentences and paragraphs and pages and all that, and essays. That's why college is so focused on teaching students how to write. Now, all these parts really come down to the social structure and the class system. Now, it's very much inspired by political philosophy. And when you have the culture and the political philosophy in play, then that will dictate the law of the game. And that's, you know, not only the Constitution, but also the additional rules, how those are written, and new laws are written, and also how these laws are added into a set of administrative codes, how we actually act upon it. Now, there's different types of law. You have natural law, and those are the laws that we can all agree upon, such as you should not steal, you should not murder, and stuff like that. Common law is a tradition or a custom that is derived on the legal system of the United Kingdom. So the United Kingdom and all the former colonies like Canada, United States, South Africa, and Australia, they would write their laws more as a common law style of proceeding. Civil law is a set of codes. So and that's very common with Germany, France, Japan, and Russia. There's another set of civil law which would be a little different, but still under the same category, and that would be the Scandinavian countries like Denmark, Norway, Sweden, Finland, Iceland. A difference between common law and civil law could be something like this. For common law, it might say you're not allowed to smoke crack. Now, under civil law, the code might say you're not allowed to smoke mind-altering substances. They intend to regulate the same thing, but it's worded slightly different. Now, theocratic law or religious scripts that are used as a set of laws follow religious teachings. And today, perhaps Iran would be the best example. Afghanistan used to be more that way. I don't know how it is today. The Philippines have a part of it. But overall, Iran would probably be the best example. Now, when we have a conflict, we might have one or two different types of conflicts. A criminal violation or a civil law case. For civil law cases, we can choose at times to solve it through arbitration. And the United Nations have a convention of contracts how to solve arbitrage type situations. And that's where we are free to solve our disputes behind closed doors. Very often, if we actually go to court, most of the cases are solved out of court, where the two parties come to agreement and they go up to the judge and say, this is what we have agreed upon, and the judge will slam the hammer and say, cool, case dismissed. So now we looked at how culture inspires political philosophy, that inspires the rules of the game and the laws, and that will then be put into administrative code, and that are the rules that govern not only government, the public sector, but also the private sector of banks, labor, and land. And overall, it helps us decide of how to use our scarce resource. And our scarce resources are capital, land, labor, and entrepreneurship. The Constitution of the United States governs how the Supreme Court, the President, the Executive Branch, Congress, with its Senate and Congress, the lower house, operates. An important part of the government is support we the people. It also includes businesses. The way the government supports we the people and businesses is by collecting taxes through the Treasury Department, and they reallocate that for different things such as defense, roads, different types of infrastructure, driver's license, and much more. Now, the government can also sell bonds. They can sell it out to the public, but they can also sell it to the Federal Reserve Bank, and the Federal Reserve Bank can print money and give the executive branch cash. Now, the Federal Reserve Bank is separate from the government, but the chairman is appointed by the President of the United States. The powers that the Federal Reserve has, and they have to follow the rules given by Congress, and the tradition is that they can buy and sell bonds, they can buy and sell currencies, they can buy and sell certain commodities like gold and silver. They can change the interest rates. They can print money. They can change the bank reserve requirements. And something that they probably do the most of, that's communicate. Now, bank holding companies are members of the Federal Reserve Bank. And the bank holding companies work with corporations and individuals to help them in exchange of money. And that is, they want to buy and sell goods and services in exchange for money. And they need the banks to help out with that transfer. Now, corporations and individuals can engage in foreign direct investment, export or import, buy and sell currencies, buy and sell fixed income, buy and sell equities, buy and sell services. It is a system where we take things for granted sometimes, and that's the free flow of people, money, goods, and services. So when the federal government decides to extend loans to people, the loans typically flow through the Federal Reserve Bank down to bank holding companies through a standardized way of applying for money, for example, a student loan or a business loan. And when the individual and the corporations pay that loan back, it flows through the bank holding companies, through the Federal Reserve Bank, and then back to the Treasury Department. Now, to make things more complex, if we decide that we want to do business with, for example, Brazil, they too have their banking system and regulations and administrative code and their legislation and how their government operates and constitution. So when you do business on a global basis, you need to know the rules of all these places. It is pretty much like playing football or say soccer. There's rules that govern both sports. Now, the question is, how well do you know the rules? And how good are you at finding good strategies to maximize the things you can do within inside the constraints of those laws? So as soon as we leave the shores of the United States of America, and we have to deal with Brazil, Canada, China, the European Union, India, Japan, and so on, we can realize that everyone has different rules and they don't function the same way as ours. And that's where we can realize that there's market imperfections, and those market imperfections will make things more challenging. The philosophy of maximizing utility is often either inspired by Kantism or utilitarianism. So Kant would probably argue more on the stockholder theory to maximize the shareholder value of things. Now, the stakeholder theory looks at maximizing the value for not only the shareholders, but also all the stakeholders, such as employees, customers, suppliers, banks, and so on. And that's where the stakeholder theory leans a little bit more toward utilitarianism, where it's looking at how do we maximize it for everyone, not only the ones that have invested in the company. In many countries, shareholders are viewed as merely one out of many stakeholders of the firm, besides employees, suppliers, customers, society, through taxes, vendors. In Japan, managers have typically sought to maximize the value of what they call the kiritsu, a family of firms to which the individual firm belongs to. So that means that they care about not only company with all its employees and so on, but also the community that they are a part of. So that means that McDonald's might be a part of that. It might be another part where you have the vendors and the people that offer up gasoline that, you know, fuels the vehicles to drive and so on. So they really look at the family of that community, not the nation as an entirety. Now, the legal protection of shareholders is fairly weak, in some cases not even existing in many emerging and transitional economies, such as Indonesia, Korea, and Russia. Our culture inspires our philosophy, and the philosophy inspires the politics and the rules of our nation, our constitution. The sovereign government has the right to regulate the movements of goods, capital, and people across our borders. These laws sometimes change unexpectedly, typically when there has been some sort of crisis. Now, these laws will inspire policy and administrative code. These rules of the game are very important to understand, and it's very important to understand your competitors, because if you understand your competitors and the rules of the game, you will probably win every time. Thank you, students, for watching this lecture. I hope you liked it. Please make sure that you subscribe so you get updates as I upload them to YouTube. If you have any questions, please email me. And as always, make sure that you honor the social distance and avoid any nasty bug out there, because you don't want to get sick and you don't want to make other people sick. So let's get this nasty coronavirus out of here so we can go back to our normal classroom at Concordia on campus. It's more fun and social. Okay, see ya. Take care. Bye.